spent yesterday in the Monterey Bay area. It was about as beautiful a nature setting as we could possibly find in this world, without question. But it, you know, as far as how I felt, didn't do anything for me in terms of how I feel. I'd much rather focus in on truth. There's no truth to be found just really looking at nature and flowers and the ocean and things like that. Not really at all. Ideal day in the world, and yet I just feel like empty. You know, it's like nothing, well, I feel nothing really profound there at all. And one thing I noticed also moving around is the constant presence of dogs. I've started to notice more and more how that affects society, actually. You can't go outside anywhere without seeing people walking dogs. And there was one place we went where there was no dogs. Lodge at Pebble Beach. No dogs. And it's a different feeling. You're relating with people. People are relating with one another. When you go out on the beach, everybody has dogs. Dogs are everywhere. So this completely changes the whole feel of a situation. And I think it's very, very bad. There should be dog laws, actually. You know, when you can walk your dog. You should not just have a society where everybody feels free to have their dogs wandering around, and wherever you go, they're just dogs wandering around. What is that? And I'm becoming attuned to this. You say, now, wait a minute. See, everywhere I'm looking right now, there are people walking and jogging with dogs, just everywhere. And on the beach, everywhere, dogs. A dog runs up to me, you know, jumps on me, and just run around there. Oh, sorry. And it's just, it just completely alters the overall vibe of the place. Of course, well, that's what people want. They want to focus on animalness, human animalness, right? They don't want to focus on truth. And the whole setup of this world, right, is that helps preclude us from folk seeing the clear difference between absurdity and truth. The whole purpose of the spiritual path is to see clear-cut difference between absurdity and truth. That's the purpose. That's really our responsibility and purpose. If you go to any park, any place outside now, it's just dogs, 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 dogs. That and people constantly obsessed with their phones. Imagine trying to talk with somebody and you realize that they have to check their phone every 2 seconds and on. You know, this is a culture that is trying to not see the difference between absurdity and truth, and believing that that will make absurdity true. Very clear cut for me. And the people here spend their time obscuring clear distinction, obscuring it, confusing and obscuring it, and thinking that this is leading them to the truth. Leading them to say that there is no truth, which is an absurdist conclusion, and then that they believe they'll be happy. They think they believe that happiness is something they can just define for themselves, and whatever definition they get for happiness, that's happiness, that's contentedness. But functioning as God created us to function, and being aware of this functioning, is our happiness, and there's no way around that. Well, as you might expect, and I might expect, and we all might expect, the clarifications are coming at a very fast pace now. And that's very good, because the troubles are coming at a very fast pace too. And focusing on absurdity, because we come to this world, and this world is custom made for us to try and make absurdity true. That's why we come here, to try to make absurdity true. And we believe, but I saw this morning, I was just like, wow, it's a game changer. That absurdists believe if they get a real good student who really pays great attention to them, that will mean that what they're teaching as true. So in other words, they teach absurdity, and then they want good students, and they believe this means what they're teaching is true. And just like, this rocked me, this insight, because it's so relevant. This is how the world hijacks our attention and our purpose for the teachers that come here to free us from absurdity. I'm going to reverse here 1 second. Wow. I'm going to go into here. Gas station. Nice reversal there. Wow, haven't done that before. So all these people, I said, oh, okay, that makes sense, because people want me to pay attention, absurdists. They said, listen to what, you're supposed to pay attention to what I'm teaching you. And they realized I was a super good student. And so they thought that I could make them true if I was just be a great student of theirs, except they were teaching absurdity. And this is why I've been so miserable. I haven't understood. And they say, well, if you don't succeed in making absurdity true as a great student, that means you're not a great student. And therefore, how can you possibly learn from any of these other teachers you're talking about? You're a lousy student. First make absurdity true. First make me a great teacher by your being a great student. So they think that becoming a great teacher is dependent on a great student learning their lesson, learning what they have to teach. And then they say, okay, well, if you've learned what I had to teach perfectly, that means I must have been teaching perfection. It's like completely backwards. It's so backwards here that it's stunning, actually. The backwardness, the upside down and backwardness here of absurdity. Coming into this world, now I see that the world is full of these absurdist teachers who are looking for, they feel the reason why they're frustrated is not because of they're teaching absurdity, because there's not good enough students who will believe what they have to say. That the students make the absurdity true. So you come in here and they hijack your consciousness, your attention, your patterns of attention, and say, your job is to make absurdity true. And we are the focus to help you do that. Oh, gosh. This is really extraordinary. So, again, the wow is to allow this to generalize without trying to specify it. If we try to specify how it's generalizing, we prevent the generalization from happening. So this full stop in the wow is the genius move. So a teacher, if you come into this world to teach truth, you have to be very adamant that you're a teacher of truth, not a student. Otherwise, everyone here will just, again, do what they always do. But that's why they have lineages of teachers, and the teachers have students, and they say, if you're going to be a student, you're going to be a student of this enlightened teacher. And don't allow the world to usurp your attention, the world of absurdist teachers, because they will. Well, that's why we have religion. So I'm a member of this religion. I listen to the teachers of this religion that is supposedly teaching me the truth, although most of that is absurdist also. This whole world is a place that absurdity has projected in our minds. We've projected this world. It's a reflection of our desire that truth not be true, which means we really want absurdity to be true. This is what this world actually is functional purpose is. So there's just all this systems of education here, which is teaching absurdity, actually. And those who feel that they're qualified to everyone here wants to be qualified to be a teacher of absurdity. They think that's the only way for absurdity to be true, is for them to be a teacher of it. And then, of course, what is there a teacher without students? Wow. Oh, man, this... It's better to see it. You have to see this so you know how to treat it. I mean, it's the sickness here is just, it's the sickness of absurdity. That is the illness. And once we see that, then we can begin to say, oh, okay. Don't feed it. I don't know, all the flags are at half-mast. Well, they should be at half-mast continuously, because this is an absurdist world. And everyone is suffering hideously and not getting right teaching, because the convergence of all these trends in the world is to converge to say we all have to be students of absurdity. If we all just learn from the teachers of absurdity, then absurdity will be true. And then we say, but then truth, of course, must make us happy, therefore we'll be happy. So it's like completely reversed, upside down, backwards logic. It's called insanity, actually. And again, when you see this, don't try to specify how it's generalizing. Just allow it to generalize. This is the key. Full stop in the wow. Wow. The wow means, oh, this is really going to generalize. This is just massive generalization. This is just going to spread out throughout my whole belief system. Yeah, so just let it spread out naturally. Don't try to force it. Don't try to pick and choose what it generalizes to. Just let it naturally, let the recognition naturally generalize as it will. Talked to a doorman yesterday at Pebble Beach Lodge. It's nice to be humble, and I just sort of hung out in that area a little bit, and I just asked him. I made eye contact and treated him like a, like he's brother in spirit, which we all are, even though we're pretending to be absurdist. And I said, "Hey, do you really have to? You have to spend two nights at the lodge to play Pebble Beach?" He says, "Yeah, that's right," which is astronomically expensive. Okay, I said, "Okay, well, maybe I'll see you next time." And then we standing outside the door. He's a doorman that opens and closes the door for everybody. And then he pops back out the door and says, "Oh, I just want to tell you. Actually," he says, you can call the pro shop. Just call them up. And the night before, the evening before, call in the evening and say, look, put me on a standby list. And if you have any spaces tomorrow, let me know. And they'll get you out that way. You just pay the green fees. You don't have to pay two nights at the lodge with all the expenses that incurs." He says, "Yeah, because they don't always have enough players from the lodge to fill up, the starting times of a day, and so they want extra money. So they have a list of players that want to get on, and they'll put them out. But of course, it costs." It's astronomical, the green fees. Anyway, it's like I think $600 basically. Then a cart is about $80. So you're taking, tips and everything. It's crazy. And yet all these people are playing it. Hey, maybe I'll play Pebble Beach. We can get out there and play it every day. Yeah, why not? Why not? If you had the money. It's certainly, the setting is certainly spectacular. However much that means in an absurdist world. But, I don't know, I kind of wandered around the lodge, just got to look at everything. Kind of helps normalize the place. Walked on the putting green. It takes some of the mystique out. It's a place that probably has more mystique than just about any other in the world. It's very heavy in mystique, Pebble Beach. So if you take the mystique out of it bit by bit, then the mystique is gone, and then you feel comfortable and relaxed. This is kind of like a reduced intensity zone world where you take the mystique out of it. So that was very helpful to do that. We'll see what the Holy Spirit has next in store for me and for all of us. Now, if we contrast the great teachers that I know of, my teachers, and then contrast them with the teachers of this world, secular teachers, even some secular religious teachers. One of them is absurdist, and the others are not. One category is certainly absurd, and the other is not. They can't both be teaching the truth, because they're completely teaching completely different, opposite teachings. How can that both be true? The absurdists say that, oh yeah, well that's no problem. The absurdity, believing that it's true, it says it can claim just anything. Whatever it says is true is true. Doesn't matter what it is, because we're trying to be prime creator, so we think that we establish truth. So it says, oh yeah, both truth and lies can be true, that's no problem. Our two mutually conflicting teachings, they say, oh yeah, no, both are true. So to teach that only truth is true and nothing else is true is one teaching. The other teaching is that both absurdity and truth are true. And then absurdity says, ah, no problem, both teachings are true, which is, of course, just complete teaching, complete conflict. Wow. Oh my gosh. This is generalizing, you know, just. And I'm seeing in hindsight my life, and wow, this is right on the money. So just let it generalize. You don't seize upon, if some insight arises, let it arise. You don't seize upon it. Because we've seen the root insight that has the power to generalize. It's so important. It's flipping the script to an extraordinary extent. We just have to get used then to having this clarity. This is always the way on the path. There isn't really any other way. You have to allow it to generalize. The art of allowing it to generalize is the art of being a true student. Student of truth. Let it generalize here. This is the art of the wow. Again, you want that G-force wow that pins you back in your seat. Your eyes are kind of fairly wide open. It's just going, wow. This is really going to generalize profoundly. You know it. See, the wow is saying, oh my gosh, this is really going to alter the entire landscape of my belief system, my belief. No question about it. This is what's called the wow. Look at it as just wow and refuse to get specific at this point. Just sort of hang out loosely and just, I'm not going to do anything about it. Just as the entire landscape is altered. Oh. This is quite different than just sightseeing some pretty trees and countryside. This is quite different. This alters the landscape of our belief system profoundly changed for the better. The song is playing in the store. Clowns to the left, jokers to the right, stuck in the middle with you. Right? That's a very funny. Clowns to the right, jokers to the left, stuck in the middle with you. Ah. So as this truth generalizes, we just have to continue to stay confident and have faith in the path. Have faith in the path. Have faith in the wow. Keep breathing, because we can't really quantitize it. We must stay out of the quantitizing aspects of our consciousness. The way we've said, our attention patterns, really. Patterns of attention. We call consciousness is patterns of attention. It's not pure awareness. It's patterns of attention. And so we have to stay out of the consciousness of quantification. Very important on the path. This is why, again, this world, which is stressing quantification in every last aspect of our lives, we're supposed to become just robotic quantifiers, is so absurdist. How can you allow these generalizations of truth to happen when you say that nothing can happen unless it can be quantified? If we can't quantify it, we reject it. This is, you know, absurdist. We don't want to live in an absurdist consciousness. This world is an extraordinarily absurdist consciousness. It's been outed as such. Right? I mean, this, the great thing about this time we live in, it is the era we live in, is that it's outing us. We're getting outed as absurdist. Our patterns of attention, our premise, the absurd premise is being outed. Because we're clearly seeing what absurdity prefers. It's being clearly pointed out what absurdity prefers. And so then we have to say, oh my gosh, I must be having an absurd premise. Or we double down on absurdity. And that's, crosswalk people. They've got to look. They're looking at their phones. You have to look in the rearview mirror now, because a lot of people are not paying attention and they're checking their texts and they're going to rear end you twice now. The last two weekends, I've had to take evasive measures to avoid getting rear ended by tech drivers who are not paying attention. This is extraordinarily selfish on their part. Absurdist on their part. When you're driving, you're supposed to pay your eyes are supposed to pay attention as much as possible. You know, I can talk like this taping, just like I'm talking to a passenger, except it's less distracting because I'm talking to myself. I'm not trying to listen to any responses. There's no back and forth. So that doesn't do anything much at all to my awareness of the driving. But it's when you take your eyes off the road, taking your eyes off the road is, that's where the problem is. Part of the absurdist position is that we can't leave this world, that we're stuck here. What else would absurdity say? A place custom designed to try and make absurdity true and to confuse the difference between truth and lies. Of course absurdity is going to value this place. It's going to value it so much and it feels it's the only refuge from truth that of course it's going to say that you can't leave it. Oh, there's no way to leave here. That's the only place there is. There is no other place. Of course absurdity is going to say that. There is no other way anywhere else. Only this world designed to help out absurdity is the only place there is. Of course, absurdity will say that. So here we have a very important recognition, is our belief that we're bodies, that we're stuck here, that this world's the only place there is. This is our home. This is all completely absurdist. Totally. And this is exactly what absurdity would say. Fearing truth, that there might be somewhere else that is not so supportive of of absurdity. It's not so supportive. Here, this is like absurdist heaven. Everybody here is absurd, almost. The way the world functions is absurd. So, of course, absurdists will say, oh, I'm not leaving here. Are you kidding? And then from that, then say, I don't want to leave here. It terrifies me. And then from that fear, they draw a conclusion, an arrogant mandate. There is no other place. There is no way to get anywhere else. This, we're stuck here. There, you know, that's a false conclusion that they would draw, isn't it? It most certainly is. Wow. Stunner. What amazing conclusion. What amazing insights here. Wow. Real progress is being made. If you know, this is the essence of real progress, is to recognize the roots of thinking that we're stuck here and realize it's just an arrogant assertion on our part to try and defend absurdity. Oh my gosh. Wow. And I've seen the only way to unravel the madness here is to recognize the absurdity, that it's an absurdist belief system that reaches absurdist conclusions and defends itself in an absurd way. If we try to take it seriously, we get trapped into it. But yet continuity fear asks us to take it seriously. So this is the fine line. We have to go, we can't take it seriously, but we have to gradually accept the non-seriousness of absurdity. We know it's absurd, but we all kind of gradually, we take a look at it gradually. This is called the repentance, means that we know it's absurd. We accept, okay, this is all absurd. We have free will. God gave us freedom. So we are free to entertain absurdity if we want. And so this is textbook obvious situation where we've been entertaining absurdity. So repentance is to accept this. Say, okay, all right, I agree that this is what it is. But I'm a little afraid to see, you know, to unravel it all, so to speak, to claim my freedom. As Jesus said, we took our freedom and in our playing with it, tried to imagine that it doesn't exist, and this is this world. He said, this is what the belief in time, the belief in this world, valuing this world, it's our playing with our freedom in a way that we want to believe that freedom doesn't exist. It doesn't exist. So that's absurdity. And looking at this has brought us to this most cherished recognition that the conclusions that we have been following about our life, our body life here, our situation, the world, all this, false conclusions entirely. The idea we can't be anywhere else, there's no other dwelling place. As Jesus said, there's many, 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 many dwelling places. If this were true, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you. And of course, absurdists will say, no, if Jesus can't prepare a place for you, there's no other place. No Jesus, no other place. This is home. This is where we're doomed to live and die, and we don't want anything else. Wow. So in order to be a teacher, come into an absurdist situation, you have to be so adamant, you cannot take it seriously. You cannot. And they don't like that here. They say, no, this is the only this is truth. You must take it seriously. You must be a student of absurdity. And be a very serious student. And so if you're not, they think you're insane. You're retarded. See, absurdity thinks truth is insane. Insanity believes truth is insane. That's the definition of insanity. And so it's completely reversed, upside down, backwards here. Just as the teachers have told us. So how easy it is to lose faith in truth here in this world. How easy it is. We need to forgive ourselves for getting confused. This place is the pit of confusion here. And then on another level of meaning, there is no pit. That's the confusion. They think they're in the pit of confusion. There isn't any pit to be in. But this world supports the notion that it is a pit of confusion. That's its purpose. And yet, there's no such thing as non-abidance even in this world. But absurdity ferociously defends the notion that no. Abidance might be other places, but not here. Not here. It's not here, and especially not here now. It might be other times. Might be other places, but never is it here now. Of course, if there's no such thing as not abidance, how could it not be here now? So again, we must forgive ourselves. Almost everyone here in this world, with the exception of those the teachers of God, train themselves in absurdity. This is their obsession. This is their fixation. And they pursue it, lifelong pursuit of it, trying to never ever deviate from this. And this is literally the situation here. I'm seeing this dog lady walking all these dogs, so many professional dog walkers. And I realized that, you know, we use dogs to try and train us that I'm just an animal. I'm just like a dog. I'm just, you know, very friendly, but sort of instinctual, and just, that's all I am. I'm not intelligent enough to understand truth. No, of course not. We use animals that way, that we're not really... It kind of, you know, absurdity is so stressful, and I mean, I just need a nice pet to calm me down from this. And so you hang out with dogs, you start thinking like dogs. Hang out with animals, you start to think like them. This is very true. I've experienced this myself. I don't have any desire to hang out with dogs. I mean, dogs are friendly. They think that you're the greatest. And here's another thing. Again, I said the absurdists, they think that if the pupil just pays rapt attention to them, they must be a great teacher. So absurdity must be true. And that's how they make sure. Well, what more rapt pupil can there possibly be than dogs? They look at you like you're God. You know? So absurdists want to be seen as God, and they get a dog that treats them as if they were God. It's an ego trip. You get with a real teacher, you know, and they're going to point out the absurdities, says you got to work at this. Whereas a dog will just like a rapt pupil, just, oh, what do you want me to do next? You know, it's like a slave. and anything, come here, sit down, go over there, quiet, here, here's some food. Oh, thank you so much. Oh, you're so wonderful. It's an ego trip, having a dog. It's a big ego trip. Now, there are those who are suffering, and they you know, well, of course, absurdity brings suffering. So, I know that, dogs, a lot of people lean on their pets. I very understand that. But at the same token, we have to wean our way away from that, okay, to truth. It's not like we can say, well, I can just remain absurdist but be happy, and this animal is going to help me do that. That'll never work. That's an absurd conclusion. So I used to be very much a big animal person, and then dogs and cats and all sorts, and now I'm not anymore. So I recognize what's really, really taking place. It's absurdity saying, "Well, I don't have the capacity to understand what you're talking about. My dog doesn't either, and my dog will back me up on that, right? Who's right? The spiritual teacher or me, dog? Oh, the dog likes me better. I must be right. Of course, I feed the dog and train the dog, and the dog thinks I'm God. See, the dog thinks I'm God. How come you don't think I'm God? You should be a pupil like the dog is, like to listen to me raptly as I confess, you know, absurdity. And it's so tough in an absurd situation, because absurdity just simply feels, again, that it dictates what truth is. So it thinks you're being arrogant. It thinks the teachers of truth, when they come here, they think that they're being arrogant. I say, wait a minute. Absurdity believes that it can simply make up and dictate what truth, whatever it wants it to be true, regardless of what truth really is. And a teacher of truth comes in and says, you can't do that. You can't make up your own truth, that God created truth and it's unchangeable. And absurdity says that the teachers of God are absurd, are arrogant. Teachers of God are arrogant. And that absurdity, which claims it can just make up any old truth it wants, is not arrogant. And that's completely backwards. Obviously backwards. And yet, this, no one even bothers to even look at this here. Well, yesterday was quite a day. In terms of eye candy, natural beauty, I think it tops just about it tops almost everything that I've ever seen. It was Pacific Grove, where the greatest beauty was, and it was the walk along Pacific Grove going out to the point there, and massive banks of yellow flowers. It's kind of a cloverish type of plant that puts out these yellow flowers, along with lupin and you know, some succulent plants of red flowers, and then you had the ocean and the bay and the rocks there, everything all together. It was like as much, and the trees, cypress trees, so it's like as almost like as much beauty as you could pack into this world. So I was just walking there, taping, and but you know, it's like, it doesn't really move the needle that much, actually. But this had all the elements of nature all compacted together there in a most intense way. Just a gorgeous sunny day, gorgeous low tide, mellow surf, all the sounds of the ocean and the birds and the people and the, you know, the town and everything mingled together. So it's kind of like an ideal place right then. But again, I left it, say okay, went to other places that were also quite beautiful beaches with all the stones, just the rocks, so many rocks there at real low tide is when we were there, And that was where the beauty gets unveiled, or whatever you want to call it. Low tide. But it's not nearly as compelling, not even fractionally as compelling as to what we're talking about here, of lifting the veil on absurdity. It's like we're at low tide now in the world, and we can see the absurdity. We can see where it's going. It's like, wow, no thanks. So absurdists try to imprison themselves. And there's no prison, really, but they just define. They think, well, I can, whatever I define is true, so I'll just define that I'm in a prison here. I can't leave the world. I'm stuck here. It's our only home. These are just definitions of absurdity. And then absurdists think that they're bound by these definitions, which is proof that they're not absurd. No wonder why teachers laugh. You know, they have to. So it's just this tangled net web of absurdity. And absurdists demand that everybody else also be absurd, to thereby give witness to its power. It's not absurdity, that it's truth, prime truth. This is what absurdity wants to be seen as. It's prime truth. Had another gorgeous day here in California, which is terrible. I mean, the clock of doom is ticking here. This has been a disaster. We expected El Nino to just pump massive rain January and February, and we've got nothing. Another drought year. This El Nino was supposed to be a drought buster. And, you know, but it's still possible in March, April, and May. Those are the, we still have 3 months that are possible. So, but with every passing month, it gets closer to doom here. Certainly it's not going to rain in summertime. And if we don't get more rain here, we are going to be in drastic, dire circumstances. Yeah, the Golden State. You know, you go to Pacific Grove and Pebble Beach and all this 17-mile drive, and it's, oh, it's so nice, so beautiful. But guess what? Oh, we have no water. Oh. Huh. Whoa. Like, we need water? And of course, absurdists blame us. So it's your fault for not making me happy. If you were just a better student and had learned to learn the teachings, absurdity that I was teaching you, I'd be happy. So we put happiness in the hands of others, that they have to learn what we're teaching them, absurdity, in order for us to be happy. Oh, wow. Thank God. This is really profound. So we come into this world, if you come in happy, and they say, oh, no, your happiness, I'm not happy, so therefore you can't be happy because you're not being a good student. So you're bad. And the only way you can be good is to make me happy by being a perfect student of absurdity and therefore proving that absurdity is true. And so then we're taught the way to be happy is to teach absurdity and get others to believe it. Oh, wow. Well, all glory to God, the Holy Spirit. All glory to God, the Holy Spirit, for orchestrating this magnificent path. Holy Spirit orchestrated yesterday, which was, I guess, a comparison. But interesting. I was told I needed to go there, and I ended up there without even trying. It's like sitting on the patio of Pebble Beach Lodge, having lunch in the patio, looking overlooking the 18th Green, Carmel Bay. Is that Nirvana? Well, I got to test it out. And the answer is no. It's not at all. Got all these birds looking at you, waiting for you to leave. As soon as you leave your table, boom, they pounce on the table. They said, there's a sign, please do not feed the birds. We are partnering with a green company who is helping the re-educate the birds, recondition the birds, so that the birds will return to their natural habitat. Please do not feed the birds. And we're like, in the bird's natural habitat, it's hard to find food. Okay, it's a struggle to survive. Here, all they got to do is wait for you to leave, all these patrons to leave their tables, and they just pounce on all the scraps. So it's people give food too. Say, the birds say, hey, you know, it's easier here. But why do we want to go back to our natural habitat? It's like, well, we need to re-educate the birds. I mean, are they that stupid? Birds are not stupid. They know where their bread is buttered. It's pretty amazing. They think that the so these birds were having none of it. We got to re-educate these birds back to their natural habitat. It's like re-educating crows to get out of all the suburbs, you know, because the crows found out this is where all the food is. What are you going to do? Send them back out on the farm or something? I don't know. Birds go where the food is. We're in another high-pressure system right now, California. It's supposed to be gorgeous this week, but it's gorgeous doom, is a way to put it. We live in a state of gorgeous doom here. We have been trying to find happiness within an absurdist perspective, thinking we need to teach absurdity and have people learn absurdity from us in order to be happy. Ah, my gosh. Instead of just accepting that happiness is our natural condition, the natural condition of truth, we make happiness as a goal to be attained through, again, this dynamic of teaching absurdity and having the others learn it successfully from us, which we then believe will prove that absurdity is true, which then will make absurdity bring us happiness. Oh, really? Starting out as a very wowish day. A very wowish day. There's a lady walking along the sidewalk. She suddenly stumbled. I saw her. She's got got earbuds on, smartphone, sunglasses. She wasn't looking at the sidewalk. And she almost fell. But will she stop being distracted? Answer is no. As long as we just stumble. Even when people fall, will they stop? No. So what is it, for instance, if we talk about how do we wean everyone away from absurdity? Well, how do you wean someone away from a smartphone? Because absurdity is like a billion times more addictive than a smartphone. And if we can't even wean anyone away from smartphones, how are we going to wean them away from absurdity? That's a question. What will motivate them? Now, absurdists think they can fake being a great teacher by using drugs because they seem to be happy and disposed naturally, at least relatively so to other absurdists, and therefore they think they can get the attention of I'm a spiritual teacher. Look how relaxed I'm so happy, but they're really drunk and on drugs, and they think nothing of that. Say, well, it doesn't matter because if I can get the students' full attention, and I can get the students just completely believing what I'm saying, then it will be true, and I'll be a true teacher at that point, which means I'll be happy. So the drugs and all that stuff, it doesn't matter. See, it's just a means to an end, and once I reach the end, everything is fine. I just to be able to, since I'm truth, anything I say is true. So if I say I'm happy, I'll be happy. This is literally how we have been thinking. Cuckoo's nest. It really is a cuckoo's nest, and you have to be super willing to recognize this. It's a lifetime for me of trying to get to this. Really, it's very, very, very resistant. Wow. Now, typically, we try here to avoid looking at the absurdist nature of our belief system. And so we will try to stay busy so we don't, so someone can't say, oh, gee, you're not doing anything. Maybe you could look at this. Oh, no, I'm working on this. I got this. So we try to stay very distracted and very busy. Now, for me, I always feel like I don't really have anything to do. I never make an excuse like I'm busy. No, I'm never busy. So what's your plans? I don't have any plans. I don't know. What are you going to do? I don't know. I just don't know. So I mean, you could sit down now for 10 minutes. Oh, yeah, I can give it 10 minutes. I can give it an hour. Yeah, sure, an hour, a couple hours. Sure, why not? I don't have anything to do. This is very important. Now, because this world is so much obsessed with distraction, preoccupation, you might call it, very preoccupied continuously. If you're just sitting there like nothing to do, sometimes you could feel like, oh, wow, maybe I better do something. So it's maybe wiser to do a few things, like exercise a little bit, get fit, or, you know, eat properly. Don't obsess about it at all. I just get a system down that works, and just go, okay, I'm eating healthily. So somebody who comes along who's preoccupied with health cannot hook you. Someone who comes along who's preoccupied with fitness, and health and fitness are two of the great preoccupations that we have. You can say, oh yeah, no, I do that too. You know, I don't need to be any more preoccupied than I am. So you can't be easily hooked into that. The middle path of so you're not hooked in any direction really, and so you're never too busy to pay attention to truth. You're never too preoccupied. And someone says, hey, you know, let's go out run. I said, well, I got my running in this morning, or I feel I'm very fit actually, and so I don't need to go running right now. Maybe later I'll do that, and then right now I'll spend a couple hours on truth. Okay, so this is part of the secret of the path is not now, but maybe later. Not right now, but maybe later, because you're already eating what really nutritiously, and you're already have exercise, and you're in good shape, and you're already. So you keep yourself that. Well, I'm already good enough to say not now. So you need to be good enough to say not now. And then now. You give your attention to truth, to now. Now you give your attention to now. This is how it has to happen. And everybody's thinking, well, no, as soon as I have some time, I'll do that. As soon as and then what do they do? They say, oh, okay, I'll see you a little later. Well, they do frantically plunge into preoccupation. It's exactly what happens. This is why teachers have to be very adamant here. It's just, you have to be purely adamant that no, you do this now and set up your life up this way. Otherwise, you'll plunge yourself into preoccupation here and never get anywhere. That's absolutely so. So I've always been willing to give the time right now to truth. And to do the other stuff later. Give your best to truth. Now, let's say you get up in the morning, you're kind of fuzzy and you know, Sometimes you feel really clear-minded if you've been doing a lot of contemplation. You wake up early in the morning, but let's say you have to get out of bed, you're fuzzy. Do your exercising, do your running, do whatever you do, get your nutrition in. When you're still kind of fuzzy-minded, then when you get going in the day and you're real clear-minded, then give that real clear-mindedness to considering truth, as we're doing here. Considering, seeing through the absurdist nature of this world of existence. Seeing the absurdist nature of it. And then when someone says, hey, you know, what are you not doing so much? How about we do this? How about this? You say, no, I already did it. I already took care of that. Or no, I'm good for right now, but maybe a little later I can do that. Now, if you're like grossly out of shape and you try to say that, then the people start pressing you on it. Say, why not so fast here? You know, you look like you really could benefit from that. They start chipping away at you. Whereas if you're looking good, looking strong, I mean, everything seems okay. People look at you and say, oh, well, he doesn't really need to work out or need to worry about nutrition or weight loss or anything. So they kind of have to leave you alone. They can't really hook you. And absurdists are hookers. Okay. You might say this whole world is nothing but a bunch of hookers in terms of functionality. And this is a truism. Everybody in this world is a hooker. As a truism. Okay, and of course when we talk about truisms, we know that of course there's going to be some outliers, anomalies, exceptions to that, because there's some that are getting with it. All right, of course. So when you speak in terms of truisms, the super generalizations, of course we understand. We're not including those who are not that way, but that those who are not that way are very minimal. So it's perfectly acceptable to speak in truisms and generalizations. Absolutely it is. And absurdism hates that. It hates generalizations and truisms. No. Everybody's different. You can only speak about one person at a time. Well, okay, this person's a hooker, this person's got a hooker, this is a hooker, this is a hooker, this is a hooker. Out of a million people, a million are hookers. So what do you mean? I have to keep one at a time. It's like counting the grains of sand on the beach. You conclude, you say, you know, this beach is full of grains of sand. There's a lot of grains of sand. Almost all this beach are grains of sand. There's a few rocks here that are not, but almost all of it. No, you can't do that. You got to say, well, one at a time. That's absurdism. Truism, speaking in truisms and abstractions, threatens absurdity greatly. Greatly. It feels very threatened by this. So we're not taught how to think this way in school at all. The entire educational curriculum of this planet is an absurdist curriculum. It's an absurdist curriculum. They're just all being taught by hookers. This is like an absurdist brothel where everyone here is a hooker. Speaking from using the truism style of speaking here, so you can tell if you're listening from the standpoint of being repentant, that you're not bothered by this truism type of speech. You get it. You say, okay, I understand that. Obviously, you know, like the Corinthian liar thing. Someone from Corinth. Came to Athens or something and said, hey, everyone from Corinth is a liar. Don't trust them. They're all liars. And then they said, wait a minute, you're from Corinth, and so you must be a liar too. Therefore, everyone in Corinth must be telling the truth. This is obvious confoundment. So what the way to resolve this dilemma is to realize that the person coming from Corinth was speaking from a truism standpoint. They didn't mean that out of the population you can't find a single one who isn't a liar. But there may be just very few. So it's not really something that gets in the way of making a truism, generalized truism statement at all. Basically, don't trust anyone from there. And in terms of you're going to go into a trustworthy situation, it's a truism. So there's no inherent paradox or conflict there at all. This person might be one of the few that is not. But you don't want to say, well, there's some that are and some that aren't. You know, then this is a confusing statement. We'd rather realize that, you know, how do we approach this? So in this absurdist world, we don't want to say, well, some are absurd and some are not. No, we basically say everyone's here is absurd. Virtually everyone, from the standpoint of a truism. And we cherish the ones that are not, that are not absurd, a few victorious ones, and those that are being helped by them. So that's why I say listening in the mood of repentance is essential, because the teachers have to speak and use truisms and abstractions. And if you allow the egoic mind, the absurdist mind, to have equal say, that's not repentance. Repentance is to put the absurdist mind on hold. So you're not gonna talk. You're not gonna have any say in what I'm doing right now. I'm gonna be listening, and you're not gonna be interrupting or disturbing or disrupting it. This is what mood of repentance, which can handle abstraction and truisms. It's like we say, well, we don't want sand. There's a beach full of sand. But we don't want any sand. Okay, well, this beach has got sand. We don't want that beach. Absurdism would say, well, we don't want the beach, but we got to determine which part of the beach we don't want and which we do. So you got to go grain by grain by grain, the whole beach. Well, how long is that going to take? As absurdist. Say, well, we don't want to, you know, eject anything. It might not be sand, you know. It's like we want a shell beach, not a sand beach. Or a rock beach, whatever. That's an absurdist. I've got to count all the grains of sand, no. Or you can flip the thing and say, well, there's a beach, but it's full of rocks. Say, I don't want a rocky beach. I want a sandy beach. Well, do we got to count every single rock to make this determination? Say, there's too many rocks here. I was at a rocky beach yesterday. Oh, my gosh, I never seen anything like it. Extraordinarily strewn, absolutely strewn. You can say, well, if I don't want a rocky beach, this is not for me then. Absurdism would say, wow, you got to examine every rock individually before you make any conclusions. How do you know this and that? So, there you go. Mood of repentance is essential to get anywhere. And when I say we have to be an expert listener, this is what I mean. You have to listen in the mood of repentance and remain in it. Battle to remain in it. And you get better and better and better at it. It's just like, let's say we're dreadfully out of shape. Well, you're not going to get back in shape the next day. You're going to, day by day, one day at a time. It's really the best philosophy here. One day at a time, do everything you can that day to acquire good habits. And the next day, do the same. And just keep doing that. And you know what? Amazingly, you will have good habits. And a great teacher will show up, pat you on the back, and say, you know what? You got some really good habits there. I like your habit set. You got a really good habit set. And I'm so day at a time, nose to the grindstone. You know, try not to assess it. You keep doing it. Just keep working and working and working and working and working. And so when you do get the pat on the back, it comes as a shock. Like, it's like, wow, really? I'm not trying to measure or assess how far along I am. I just keep working at it. But then when you do get a pat on the back, it's a huge recognition. It's just, wow, I have pretty good habit set. And I've gotten that recognition. I remember Ram Maharshi giving me that recognition. And what he was really saying, in essence, was you have a really, really good habit set, and it's going to get better and better and better, and I can see what it's leading to, for sure. So keep doing what you're doing. Keep working at it. You'll get there. And that there was just a profound boost that I received. So you do get these boosts. That there are, we are being watched. Our habit set is being watched. Awareness is aware of awareness, and the habit sets of attention, the patterns of attention. And when we are developing a really good habit set, really good patterns of attention, awareness is aware of this. And occasionally these teachers will give you a great boost. I had something that seemed to come from Ananda Mayama. The goddess thing is always very tricky, right? I mean, it's easy to confuse, but it was something where it was in her room. I was called in, and she said, "Here." And then she showed me all of the stuff that I had done in detail. It was astonishing. All these charts. She had all these very complex charts and everything, and we've been charting, you know, my progress, and showed me all the stuff, good stuff that I had done. She was aware of every last detail of it, and I was just amazed by it. Astonishing how much good work and good habits I've done. But there was other elements of that that I wasn't sure exactly what it meant. There was some saucer element at some point. And the people were all kind of like jealous of me too. Like, how come he's getting your attention, we're not? And the answer is because he's working every day getting good habit set. That's what I'm looking for. And then Longchenpa coming to see me, you know, he's not going to do that if you have a terrible habit set, right? Because then he'd be like reinforcing, like, oh, I think you're wonderful. Look at what a great bad habit set you have. He's going to come, and he's so discerning. This is someone who's vastly discerning. He's going to be able to discern and know what your habit set is, your patterns of attention. So for him to show up, you know, that's major kudos. It means that he's saying, you've got a really, really good habit set, and I'm excited about that. And I'm looking forward to working with you, and looking forward to, you know, you being part of, you know, helping me out, helping this huge effort out, which he's so dedicated to, which these teachers are so dedicated. It's scary how dedicated they are. Yeah, I'm still like, wow, I don't know if I could ever be that dedicated. It's really extraordinary. It's pretty intimidating, their dedication. However, you know, they seem very, very happy and joyous. So, something to look forward to. So these are the big boosts that we get when we really put this effort in. So the accomplishment here is to acquire the habits that enable us to see through absurdity and clearly make a distinction between the absurd and the non-absurd. This is the habit. These are the habits that we need. So if Longchenpa is coming to see me, it means he's saying, look, you have the right habit set. Trust me on this. You're able to make these discernments because of your patterns of attention that you work so diligently on all these years. So it's a very helpful outlook. A job you want done, and you have to discern who can help you, what their habits are. You know, I mean, different habits lend themselves to different occupations. If you want to discern between truth and lies, between absurdity and non-absurdity, there's habit sets that are very helpful for that. And so I just work every day at getting better and better and better at those habits. And every day there's room for great improvement. I'm looking at this banner advertising a school, and it says, high achievement, well-rounded. Well, that's a good description when you really, really work at it. Spiritually, I feel well-rounded, most certainly well-rounded, and having somewhat high achievement, with room to improve, of course. A lot of room to improve, but overall, having reached some high water marks of being able to confirm what they're teaching us is true, that there really is this perspective we can have, and we can shift into this other perspective. This is true. I'm just working on how to stay there. How do we stay in that? And I'm finding that the conclusions of absurdity is what prevents it, actually. We keep thinking that some of the conclusions of absurdity might be true, or we take them as true, and we don't yet recognize that they're absurd. So once this absurd belief system has really been thoroughly vetted, I believe that then abidance will be easy. It will be easy. We'll be able to do it. We don't get these skill sets overnight. This is the trouble. This is why I've implored everyone my whole life, work like your life depended on these skills, these habits. Don't wait. And nobody listen. That's a truism, nobody. Of course, there may be some that have. But as far as the truism goes, nobody listened. Because what they said, what absurdity says, no, if I need a habit, I'll just decree it. If it comes up that I need a habit, I'll just decree that I can do this, and I can do it. I don't need it. I'll work on it then. Doubting Thomas. Stupid. Absurdist. So here we are now when we need a really, really good habit set right now. We really, and almost nobody has a really good habit set. And they say, oh, we're in trouble? We're in severe trouble? Oh, okay. Well, okay, what do I do? What do I do now? You're supposed to last 50 years been working on these habits. So you have a good habit set. So it's a habit set we need. Good habit set. So there's the Holy Spirit again. I was wondering, what do I do next as far as exercise? I've been wanting to like hike or do some of that. I need to build up that type of strength. Some running, some hiking. And because I tried jogging yesterday, and I forgot how to run. So it took a while. It's like, wow, I didn't have the right stride because we're doing jump rope. So somebody says, how you doing with your workout? I said, I'm doing good. He said, hey, you know, have you ever tried this or this? I said, no. He said, I really recommend it. Then he showed me a picture and he was talking me into it and gave me all these particulars of how to go about it, when to get there, how long it takes, all this stuff. I said, wow, you know what? I'm going to try that. I'm going to try it. So this is like the next step. The next step in you know, exercising progression, plus you get a great nature outing, great view, and all this kind of stuff. So, yeah, I'm going to give it a try. We'll see how that goes. Okay? Amazing. I was just looking for that. And so this is how you know the Holy Spirit. When the timing, the synchronicity, everything is so smooth blended out, you say, hey, the Holy Spirit says, you know, get working on this. Get yourself, you know, a little more fit. Fabulous. One thing I noticed in Longchenpa's practice instructions, called pith instructions, that he says if you have all the good habits, you have a set of good habits of attention, and you don't use those to attain liberation, this is gross ignorance, gross error, very bad. So I was thinking about the Catholic Church, for instance, and their purpose is to give you, help you develop a good set of habits. That's the purpose of religion. And they start out, you know, it's pretty elementary stuff, and because usually they're taking people who have terrible habits and trying to, you know, resurrect them from the death of those bad habits. Believing in death is one of our worst habits, by the way. So, yeah, they, throughout history, these religions have done a great job, by and large, of helping those who have terrible habits convert over and start developing a good habit set. So that's fine. But, that's not enough. You have to actually then use those good habits to focus on seeing through absurdity. And this is where the religions tend to come up short. Certainly, Catholic Church comes up short in this regard. They don't do it. So that's a gross mistake. Gross mistake. They teach an absurdist theology, an absurdist belief system, along with teaching good habits of attention, basic good habits, basic virtue, basic morality. It's more kind of Old Testament stuff. And then they kind of go, gee, wow, well, Jesus, wow, you know, did all this stuff. Okay, well, we want you to be a good human being, good person, and charitable, and do good works, and, you know, wow, Jesus. But they don't get to, let's look at absurdity. Let's draw a clear distinction between absurdity and non-absurdity. It's pretty rudimentary stuff, but that's understandable when you're converting, you know, severe secular humanists. That, you know, they're going to go slow, they're going to struggle. So that's understandable. But let's just call it like it is. In no way does Catholicism, or even Christianity, for the most part, the way it's being taught. The way it's being taught in churches, it doesn't take a close look at absurdity. They dance around it. And that's not good. This is what Longchenpa is saying, that you have the good habits, you got to then use them. It's like having tools, really, and you don't use them. It's like using a saw. You have a really good circular power saw, using it as a hammer, and using it as a hammer as a saw. I mean, what kind of house are you going to build if you do that? That would be pretty absurd, right? You see a carpenter, and they're trying to cut a board with a hammer. Do you say, well, you got a saw right over there, real good one, actually. Why aren't you cutting it with a saw? I say, oh, no, I'm using the saw to nail down all the nails. I say, that's kind of absurd. Why don't you use the hammer to nail the nails and the saw to cut the board? What? No, I can't do that. What are you talking, crazy? You're talking absurd. That's absurdity. So this is the trouble. We have, even the good skill sets in the world are not being applied properly. Which means they're really not that strong, right? They're kind of lukewarm. Lukewarm skill set isn't really going to get the job done. We're tackling absurdity here. And that's quite a tall order. So what a church or any religion needs is someone exhorts everyone to tackle absurdity. Use your skill set. Take up the challenge of this tremendous challenge. And this is not what's happening in Catholicism right now. It's the opposite. You have everyone being encouraged to use whatever skill set they have to avoid, to remain preoccupied and avoid really looking at absurdity. Be preoccupied with charity. Be preoccupied with good works. And as our priest said, good works without faith is very dead. Very dead, which is quite correct. The faith is that you can overcome this absurdity. You can recognize the difference between absurdity and non-absurdity. We must have this faith, and these teachers give us this faith that this is possible. And they insist we can do it. It's just a matter of applying a good skill set of attention habits and just applying it. Keep applying it, keep applying it, keep applying it, keep applying it. Like building a house, keep using the saw to cut the wood and keep using the hammer to hammer the nails. And eventually you'll have yourself a house. A house of clarity. What has to be cut through is absurdity. So our habits, it's not a matter of just having strong habits. I didn't say strong habits. I said a really effective, good habits, a habit set. A set of habits that is capable of cutting through absurdity. This is what we're called for. A lot of us will say, well, I've got good habits too, or strong habits. So we mean strong, meaning I've worked really to put a lot of effort into building all sorts of habits that I like, but these habits are bad habits in that they distract us. They preoccupy us. Habits of preoccupation are not good habits from a spiritual standpoint. Here again, we're taking a good look at this. Wow. Because yeah, if you tell somebody, well, you don't have good habits, or what are you talking about? I have really good habits. I work really, yeah. But yeah, for absurdity, a good habit is to habits of preoccupation with absurdity, avoiding clarity, habits of avoiding clarity. That's what absurdity says. That oh, you're doing a great job. And so these folks here think they're doing a great job. They said, I'm doing what my advisor tells me to do. Avoid clarity. Be preoccupied with confusion and drama and fear and all this stuff. Those are not good spiritual habits. So the church has got itself into a dilemma here, because it's not, I'm trying to help out by saying you have to apply those good habits you have to cutting through the knot of absurdity. Tibetans have some word for that, cutting through the knot of absurdity, trek show or something like that. You have to have a sharp mind, vajra mind, vajra sattva, to cut through this knot of, they call it conditioned existence. It's really absurdity. It's also it's bold. I mean, conditioned existence is absurd. That notion that it's true is absurd. But this knot, you might say, let's call it knot of absurdity. Knot of absurdity. Cutting through that knot of absurdity, this vast serpentine knot of absurdity. Just cutting right through. You need that sharpness of intention and focus and good habit and application. Like a good saw blade, you just cut right through the wood. Dull saw blades, difficult. Heats up, causes problems. Real, real carbide sharp blade, just like butter. You want your mind to be carbide vajra sattva. You want to have carbide vajra sattva. Vajra means diamond. Sattva, mind, quality of mind. Carbon. Diamond. Carbide diamond. Carbide tipped. Well, it's not actually... the tips are not diamond. If you had diamond, it would... I don't know if you can make it so it cuts even better in a saw blade, but carbon vajra sattva, carbide, super, super sharp steel, hardened steel, carbide vajra sattva. Cut through the knot of absurdity. Cut through the knot of absurdity. Cut through the knot of absurdity. This is what we're doing today, right here, right now. This is what we have been doing, and what we can will continue to do. And if you can't cut through it, it's because the blade is too dull. The blade is too dull. It's too dull, and it seems too difficult then. When it's really sharp, you go through it, and you say, well, that's not so difficult. I see this, I see this, I see this. Oh, wow. Let's go right through it. So these great religions and great teachers, they know what they're talking about. And you have to develop these really good habits, a habit set, very strong habit set, and keep sharpening it, and then apply it, apply it, apply it, apply it. Apply it. And what I believe is happening is Christians don't know how to apply it. They keep thinking it's good works is the answer. Good works is fine, but don't allow any preoccupation with good works to distract you from cutting through the knot of absurdity. Knot of absurdity. And so this is what I get. The tradition of Christianity right now is they're stalled out. And you don't want to stall out. It's a major stall out. Oh, okay. Major stall out happening right now. Big trouble. We all have habits of attention. Okay, we all have habits of attention. So it's what are your habits of attention and what are they useful for is what's important. And my habits of attention are very, very useful to cutting through the knot of absurdity. So that's what I'm doing. What we're told is that if we don't have cut through the knot of absurdity, we remain in absurdity. And this is the root of suffering. So it behooves us to have an attention pattern, habits of attention which are able to cut through the knot of absurdity. Very important. We don't have to. I mean, we can remain in the absurdist position in regard to reality and grievously suffer life, death, sickness, vulnerability, life after life, and all this despair, depression, confusion, frustration, attack, and everything. We could fear. We could do that if we want to. And the habits of attention will be used to do that. So you see people working, their habits of attention that helps, enables them to do a certain kind of work. Now, so I do have these habits of attention to cut through absurdity. So it's perfectly reasonable that someone who values that and says, yeah, these are my habits also, I value this. You know, it's a colleague, collegiality. Say, hey, I like this. I'm a colleague of yours. I'd like to introduce myself. And hopefully we can, work together at some point to further these habits of attention that are so important. And have an option to do that. So I hope that's the case, where I have an option. I need to find out immediately if this is the case. Oh, wow, they're putting up this building so fast. It's amazing. Ha! It seems like in one day they've put up this. That's extraordinary. Drive past her all the time, and there was nothing there last time I looked, and now there's like 4 stories. Oh boy. Modern building. Well, it's the way the world is going too, right? You don't. The changes, the converging trends are happening so fast. Boom! Before you know it, there's a structure of habit. Structure of habits. So the world is always pressuring us to have these certain habits. Massive pressure on us to have certain habits. And, you know, the best habit is the habit of breaking those habits, right? Because it's preoccupation. Habits of preoccupation, of not cutting through the knot of absurdity. Wow. Tailgater. Personalities are revealed by how you drive, aren't they? Habits of attention. So it all makes sense. You look at the overall picture. You have good habits of attention. They lend themselves to this work of cutting through the knot of absurdity. So you would be joining with others who do that, who are good at that. They take you under their wing. We would hope that this is so. I can't imagine that it would not be so. And so I would hope that I've had some offer to join, you know, to be taken under someone's wing and to work at this. I would hope that this is the case. If it's not, it would seem rather absurdist. It would. I mean, the issues I'm getting to are very advanced, actually, as far as cutting through absurdity. Because you just don't hear that talked about ordinarily at all. We sort of like say, yeah, well, there's something we need to get to, some absurdity, yeah, and we're kind of working on it, and maybe, you know, we could get some progress on it and stuff. But you don't really get this, you know, adamantness, really adamant. So I would hope, I would reason that there's offers to me to go under someone's wing and get some protection from them, and help and protection in return. I give, help extend this set of good habits, advocate, be an advocate for this. So this is what I'm, you know, my habits are training for, is to be an advocate of good habits, to habits that will cut through the knot of absurdity. And the foremost habit is to apply the habits, which is what we do every day. Every moment of the day, we try to work on this. And of course, we could get tired when you bring to light a massive amount of absurdity. This changes the landscape of our destiny, of our beliefs, very strongly. So this can be a shock to us, and we may feel tired. I just took a nap, a little short nap, short one, but it was a deep one. My phone gave a signal, a message came in, and I woke up, and I said, oh my gosh, I overslept. It's morning already. I thought it was an alarm that was waking me up after, you know, a night of sleep. I looked out, I said, oh, it's already light. Oh, I'm late. And then I realized, no, I'd just taken a nap, dropped off for just a few minutes. But it was a very, very strong, deep sleep then. I really forgot about the world. Coming from the tired, bringing this to light, which we've done today, it's just astonishing. of course, I want to continue with these habits, and so it would be good to see how that could happen, how that could be furthered, and this is what I hope I get help with. People who try to drive conservatively and go, you know, 65 and you know, try to drive safely, and because they just, people just, nobody does that anymore. They just blow your doors off. It's just so intense here. I wish we all could drive 65 again. But if you do, you're just under relentless pressure. It's just, and of course you get older and you get, you know, you're not just, maybe you don't want to drive so fast. It's understandable. Put the speed limit back to 55 and we'll see how folks adapt to that. That would be interesting for the tech people of Silicon Valley. It's 55 speed limit, strictly enforced. Would they be able to adapt to that? Probably not. It would just be a meltdown at that point. Truth is, a lot of these vehicles here, they're doing 80 plus. That's what's common here, 80 plus. You go, you know, whatever you're doing, most of the people, they want to go faster, get out of my way. Wow. It's just not safe to go that fast. It isn't. It brings way too much into play as far as driving goes. It's overcompensation. They're going so slow on the spiritual path, they feel they need to go faster on the materialist path. This is why materialism is such a so troublesome now, is everyone feels we've got to go faster at materialism. It's a compensation mechanism. It's absurdity trying to compensate for its own absurdity. It's like, say, let's go towards absurdity faster. That means we're making more progress. We'll get there sooner. But we don't want to go towards absurdity faster. So absurdity said, okay, let's go towards absurdity a little slower. I said, well, that's, you're still going towards absurdity. That's not right either. How about let's go fast towards non-absurdity? Oh. Yeah. Right, so I hadn't thought of that. That didn't come up in the absurdist belief system. No, a lot of stuff doesn't come up in the absurdist belief system. Like what's effective? That doesn't come up. Pragmatism doesn't come up. Turned the fan off here, but it's still blowing cold air. That is really weird. Very strange. Well, in that case, raise the temperature. Zero used to be zero. It's not zero anymore on this dial. Can't turn the fan off. We have a distracted driver here, going slow. I can see now they just pulled right in front of me. Wow. Very distracted driver. They have these earbuds on. They're glancing down continuously. They're weaving because they're looking at their smartphone. This is terrible. At least they slowed down when they did it in the slow lane. But you can tell. Say, what's wrong with this driver? They're weaving. They say, okay, you can see. In the mirror, they glancing down, looking down. the commute's already strong going south. 2:30. Uh-oh. You might say that technology, high-tech, is called masters of distraction. Masters of distraction. I mean, and they think they're masters. I got these master habits. What are those habits? Distraction, preoccupation with not recognizing the difference between absurdity and non-absurdity. And they're lionized. But they're called the dark masters. Of course, when you specialize in preoccupying yourself with distraction from habits that'll cut through absurdity, this is not a good thing at all. It's not something you pat yourself on the back and say, "You're well done. I'm a master of distraction." No, that's not good. It's not good to be like that. Very bad. They should not be lionized. In the past, they were not lionized. The church was much stronger in the past. The church basically, was a culture that was very focused on what do we highlight as far as our habits of attention go. And there's some stuff we don't want to do because historically, both here on this planet and other planets, other dwelling places, we know that this is very, very bad. And so they wisely had all sorts of rules for culture, circumscribing, all the various habits of attention that are not helpful. Now it's the opposite. It's the church that's attacked for not building up good habits of attention, which, of course, I say that they most certainly do. Their shortcoming, which is why they've stalled out, is they don't know how to apply these properly. It's sort of like the end, the means end up becoming the end. They take the means for the end. And this is a great mistake, and the stall out, which has allowed this collapse to take place. They don't know how to apply them. To what? It's just ceaseless evangelization, but do they ever apply it to absurdity? No. Rarely. Rarely, you see. That's the shortcoming. But I do not say that the churches have not worked assiduously throughout history to build up good habits. They have. Evangelize, and never look at yourself and really take the time to cut. That's not good. There should be some monastic element to it always also. Different phases, and the real high traditions understand that. And so, you go through certain teaching for a certain number of years, and then the other shift to another way, and then ultimately you may go through a monastic period for like 10 years or so, where you really apply it, learn how to apply these good habits. And then you may not stay in that continuous. You may do something else. You may then be taken under the wing of someone who's really advanced, and you may learn how to apply it in a more pragmatic sense. And that's the real tradition you need. If you just have this generic, let's have good habits here, and not knowing how to apply it, etc., that this stalls out. This is why I say Catholicism has stalled out. And the perfect example of that is the present head of the church, who is the master of the stall out. And say, okay, great, we've stalled out. Now let me turn it towards preoccupation. Distracts. Let me turn it all in this direction. So you have the stall out, and then inevitably someone arrives on the scene to exploit that stall out and then turn it away completely from its purpose, which is the present situation in Catholicism. gorgeous day around the bay. We'll see what Holy Spirit has me do. Seems to be indicating some stuff. We'll see. I don't know. In a reduced intensity zone, we may have a tech park of all these buildings, but they're just empty. Nobody goes to them. But it's just kind of reassuring, like, well, oh yeah, I remember we used to go to work on these, we had these habits that we used to go in these buildings and work. And I just like, maybe just facades, you know, inside they're kind of just empty. Right? That's the way I look at these buildings and these tech parks here. They're just, they're empty. Nobody works in them. If you want to get some sore muscles, just run on sand, or do what I did, run up and down sand dunes and run on sand. You're gonna find out you're not quite as fit as you thought. It's gonna isolate certain muscles you didn't know you had in your legs. Oh my gosh. Because of the slippage of the sand and everything, the way to running on sand is going to get your legs quite fit, actually, jogging on sand. Difficulty we have, of course, on the path. We make so much success. Our inner landscape has changes so much. And it's tiring. It's stressful, for sure. I don't know where I stand now. I made so much progress today. I just like take a nap and see where I stand after that. So I just have to trust in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will. There's a big truck that just passed me. Paradise Company, massive sign of Paradise on the truck all over. So I don't know what's next. Paradise. Okay. Very interesting. I'm in rush hour traffic right here. As soon as I said I don't know where I stand, I don't know what's next, this truck on the right came past me, and on its side and back, everywhere, just a huge letter, whole painted, the whole truck, Paradise. I said, I have to rely on the Holy Spirit. Boom. Oh my God, the Holy Spirit, the timing is just exquisite. It's just too much. My legs, my sore from running in sand. I had the energy to run, but the next day, you're gonna pay the price. That's why everyone else was walking. I've been on the sand, so I thought, I could run. So next up is Paradise. Paradise, okay. Wow, that's good to know. Where do you go when you've uncovered absurdity, the absurdity of this world? Where do you go? Paradise. Didn't Jesus say to the criminal on the cross, one of them, you will be with me in paradise. Today you will be with me in paradise. Now, it does take a lot of faith to uncover this, uncover absurdity like we have done. Because we have to have faith that something, somehow there'll be a future for us, you know, because it seems like absurdity has been our only existence. And now I see it's all absurd. I say, so what's next? That's the faith we have to have. And the Holy Spirit delivered the answer immediately when I asked the question right there. So then we would say, okay, precursors to paradise, questions about how is it going to be, how's it going to come about? Well, we don't worry about that too much. We just say, okay, paradise, a reduced intensity zone. And that's great news. And here's another truck. Etheric Networks, it says. Right next to me. Etheric. Oh my gosh. This is really something. Etheric. I mean, subtle. First, you know, subtle, another dimension. Wow. What's this? Ultra high speed internet. Etheric network, ultra high speed. Wow. Okay. The Pure Lands, in Buddhism, they call them the Pure Lands. Jesus said the kingdom of heaven, Pure Lands. Make those your goal. That's what we're told in religion. Make the Pure Lands, the kingdom of heaven, your goal. Jesus said, don't lay up treasures here in this world. Lay them up in the world that is to come, meaning to come for us, that we're, what we're headed towards, the Pure Lands, kingdom of heaven. Lay them up so that you get there, he says, where there's no corruption. He likens this world where everything gets corrupted, right? Decayed, corrupted, processes of decay here. Where there, nothing decays in the Pure Lands. Oh, looking forward to that. That is for sure. Low maintenance. Stuck in heavy, heavy, heavy traffic here. So much like when we do a physical workout, we might feel tired afterwards. Spiritual workout, you know, we might feel, you know, a bit fatigue afterwards here. I'm experiencing it. Heavy, 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 heavy lifting. We're told in the Bible, it says, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in the, you know, the end times. But what were the days of Noah? What were they talking about there? It's basically Noah tried to warn everyone and no one paid any attention. They mocked him, they ignored him, no one paid any attention. Meaning, it'll be like that in the Great Tribulation when it comes, that the people will be completely ignoring it. Not paying attention, not heeding the warnings, and just very, very distracted. Very distracted. So we cannot say that just because everybody's distracted, everybody's feeling that, oh, everything's fine here, that it means it is. Because they said, as in the days of Noah, so shall it be in those days. They were all distracted at Noah's time. They said drinking and feasting and marrying and being given in marriage and, you know, materialism. They were really heavily into materialism and scoffed at any such notion. Don't cut into our materialistic enjoyment here. We're not going to worry about that kind of doom stuff. It's nonsense. So again, we cannot draw an erroneous conclusion just because the majority of the world feels everything's going to be fine, that it will be fine. Now, what I'm doing is I'm just allowing this, the insights I've had to generalize. Just generalize. I'm not trying to force anything. Just letting it happen. And not trying to measure how profound the change will be or anything like that. The Holy Spirit just indicated etheric paradise. I said, okay. But I'm not trying to... let's go with that. That's it. Full stop in the wow. Let it all naturally generalize. Let all the changes in the belief system, you know, let them work themselves out. It's like what a tide. Let the tide come in. Change of tide here. Major change of tide. Let the tide come in and check back, you know, later when you see, oh, okay, it's come in. As long as absurdity is self-referencing, you can't seem to get out of it. You need a reference that seems it's outside of the belief system of absurdity. This is where the great teachers help us out so much. They have a different reference, right? Truth. Because absurdity is just self-referencing. It keeps churning out conclusions based on its own internal logic, which is based on premise that absurdity is true and or it can become true, or will become true, and it's mandated by God, you know. It keeps churning out these conclusions. So the only obstacle to paradise is just absurdity. which is really nothing, no obstacle. But if we don't, if we're stuck in the referencing, internal referencing of the absurdist belief system, we can't see how to get free of it. The Holy Spirit is free of it, so Holy Spirit helps us out greatly, and we will continue to be helped by the Holy Spirit. But if we just keep trying to figure it out, using the premise of absurdity, we'll just keep coming up with absurd conclusions and end up in some backwater. You know, this is the frustrating part of it. We have to have connection with that which is outside of absurdity, is free of absurdity, a different reference, to keep reminding us to keep working. You'll get there, keep working. Super helpful, because it seems like the work we do, it doesn't, you know, it's hard to assess it, because now I'm seeing, wow, absurdity has churned out so many conclusions that we've been bound by all those. And if we keep thinking, oh, this is the baseline of what God mandated, and this is false, this is absurdist, and then reason from that premise, we'll think, we'll just spin our wheels. We won't get anywhere. We have to dig. But problem is the most of us take certain assumptions as truth, and they're absurdist assumptions. So we come up against these barriers, and we say, okay, well, that's truth then. But the great teachers say, no, that's still absurdity. Now, this is what's so helpful. We have to hear the adamant teaching, the high adamant teaching. And then this enables us to keep trying, realize that we haven't got there yet. We need to keep trying. Otherwise, we'll just give up. So I still don't understand why I still feel the way I feel. I'm sure I've gone as far as I can go. No, we have not. If we see the obstacles to paradise are nothing more than completely absurd. It's just an offense of absurdity, saying you can't go anywhere else. That wouldn't be fair to absurdity. That won't help us, you know. That won't help absurdity. Can't be any other place. It's the insecurity and instability of absurdity that just constantly makes decrees to try and prop itself up. These decrees are not truth. These arrogant decrees of absurdity are not truth at all. So it is possible to go way further than what absurdity tells us we can do. Absurdity tells us you can only go so far, and then you have to stop, because the absurdity says, well, good defenses, I don't want you undoing those. That would be absurd. We got to protect absurdity. And so we stop prematurely. That's why you need religions, you need the guru system, you need the various lineage systems, you need the Holy Spirit, you need to be able to reference something outside of the context of an absurd belief system, which is all defensive. It's entirely defensive, actually. Okay. I gotta rest. This is very, very strenuous to dig all this up, but it's been dug up, and we can now go on from here.
and as the Holy Spirit indicated, paradise, which I call a reduced intensity zone.